Hey, any of you guys in there want to come sit in my chair today? Anybody? Nobody wants to come sit in my chair here? None of you? I mean, I'm giving you a golden opportunity to speak to, what, 50 million people? I can handle it. Okay, all right. So nobody wants to come sit in my chair today. Greetings, my friends. What happened? That's what we're going to try to find out. We're not going to be able to explain this away in one day. We're going to get close. We are not going to be able to come up with all the answers and solutions in one day, but I want to try to take you through today the night for me last night, various thoughts that I had as things happened, beginning with my getting and receiving the exit polls at 5 o'clock. But first thing, let me tell you, small things beat big things yesterday. Conservatism, in my humble opinion, did not lose last night. It's just very difficult to beat Santa Claus. It is practically impossible to beat Santa Claus. People are not going to vote against Santa Claus, especially if the alternative is being your own Santa Claus. Now, everybody is jumping on Romney's chain today, getting in his chili. Look, and he may have not been the most optimal candidate, but he's a fine man. He would have been great for this country. Mitt Romney and his family would have been the essence of exactly what this country needs. But what was Romney's recipe? Romney's recipe was the old standby American route to success. Hard work. That gets sneered at. I'm sorry. In a country of children where the option is Santa Claus or work, what wins? Now, say what you want, but Romney did offer a vision of traditional America in his way. He put forth a great vision of traditional America, and it was rejected. It was rejected in favor of a guy who thinks that those who are working aren't doing enough to help those who aren't. And that resonated. The Obama campaign was about small stuff. War on women, binders, Big Bird, this kind of stuff. The Romney campaign was about big things. It was about America. It's mind-boggling to go through these exit polls. You want to hear a statistic that is somewhat surprising? Romney received 2.5 million fewer votes than McCain did. Now, who would have called that? Who in the world would have? Obama, I think Obama's vote tally was down 10 million from 2008, and we still lost. We lost 50-48 nationally. We were not able to build a turnout model that looked like 2004. Very, very puzzling. Something else, just stream of consciousness here. The usual suspects are out. And they're saying, well, Russia, we got to do. We got to reach out now to the Hispanics, and we got to reach out to the minorities, blacks. We got to reach out. Okay, let me remind you of something. Just ask you a question. And we will be getting your phone calls, of course, today. Will you weigh in on this? 800-282-2882 is the number. Let me take you back to the Republican convention. We had Suzanne Martinez, female Hispanic governor, New Mexico. We had Condoleezza Rice, African-American, former Secretary of State. Both of those people, eminently qualified, terrifically achieved. They have reached the pinnacles of their profession. We had Marco Rubio. We had a parade of minorities who have become successful Americans. And they all had a common story. Up from nothing. Hard work. Their parents sacrificed for them. And people are scratching. Now, why didn't that work, folks? Because the answer to that is our future. Why didn't it work? Some people say, well, Rush, we pandered. No, we didn't pander. Everybody says that we need to reach out to minorities. We have plenty of highly achieved minorities in our party, and they are in prominent positions. And they all have a common story. They all came from nothing. Their parents came from nothing. They worked hard. They told those stories with great pride. Those stories evoked tears and didn't work. And don't tell me that people didn't watch the convention. People didn't see it. I mean, there's a reason it doesn't work. I went to bed last night thinking we're outnumbered. I went to bed last night thinking all this discussion that we'd had about this election being the election that will tell us whether or not we've lost the country. I went to bed last night thinking we've lost the country. I don't know how else you look at this. The first wave of exit polls came in at 5 o'clock. I looked at it. I read the first two pages, and I said to myself, this is utter BS. And I forwarded the exit poll data that I had to three or four people, and my message to each of them, this is utter BS. And if it isn't, then we've lost the country. Let me take you through some of it. Based on early exit polls, Obama is locked in a tight race with Governor Romney. Romney, nationally, we believe the race to be as tight as it could be. And here are the, to the extent that Obama is running strong and can win, it is because they see him as someone who cares about people like them. They feel he did a very good job in the response to Hurricane Sandy. When I saw that, I said, don't tell me. I thought this thing is starting to read like a Democrat campaign speech, this exit poll data. Hurricane Sandy in the aftermath and the way Obama handled that, what did Obama do? He showed up one day, he bear hugged Chris Christie, and then he left. Situation on the ground is devastating. And yet, Obama triumphs in the exit polls with that. He successfully painted Romney's policies as caring primarily about the rich. He successfully convinced roughly half the country that his policies will favor the middle class. Now, measure that against reality. The reality is that the economy of this country is crumbling. The unemployment situation is worsening. The debt situation is worsening. Everything for the very people who think Obama is going to help them is getting worse. And yet they told the exit poll people that they thought Obama is the best guy to handle Obamacare. A majority of people like Obamacare in the exit poll. That goes against everything we've ever heard in any poll. Voters trust him more than Romney in an international crisis. What? How in the world can that be? In a rational, intelligent world, how can that be? He's running very strong with African Americans, Latinos, and women. If he wins, this data will be consistent with stories about the changing nature of U.S. demographics. And I saw this next one. And this is the one that made me think this exit poll was BS. I intellectually had trouble with this one. More than half the people who voted yesterday said that they still blame Bush for the economy. More than half the people who, after 4 years. Well, now what is the answer to this? How in the world do you deal with this? There are ways, and we didn't do them. There were too many assumptions made about what the American people thought, about what they knew. Too many assumptions were made. But look, I don't want to nitpick a campaign today. That's not the point. There are larger things here at work. Roughly half the voters want the health care law as it is or expanded, and they are voting for Obama. Really? I haven't seen a poll like that anywhere. Every poll I have seen on Obamacare features a majority at close to 60% who don't like it. But this is an exit poll of people who voted. People who say they are looking for a strong leader and someone who has more of a vision for the future support Romney. Romney even wins among voters voting for a candidate who shares my values. Voters believe the economy's weak and Romney will be better able to manage the economy. Now, this is from people that the exit pollers say this is the reason if Romney wins, this is why. Well, obviously, those people were vastly outnumbered, which is where we are today. We're outnumbered. One of the greatest misunderstandings in this country, if you boil all this down, is what creates prosperity. The Romney campaign was essentially about that. And the Romney campaign was devoted to the traditional American view and history, vision as well, of what creates prosperity. The old capitalism, the old arguments of hard work, stick-to-itiveness, self-reliance, charity, helping out in the community, all of these things that define the traditional institutions that made this country great. That's what the Romney campaign was about. It was rejected. That way, or that route to prosperity, was sneered at. That route to prosperity was rejected. The people who voted for Obama don't believe in it. They don't think it's possible. They think the game's rigged. They think the deck's stacked against them. They think that the only way they're going to have a chance for anything is if somebody comes along and takes from somebody else and gives it to them. Santa Claus. And it's hard to beat Santa Claus. Especially it's hard to beat Santa Claus when the alternative is you be your own Santa Claus. Oh, no, I'm not. What do you mean I have to be my own Santa Claus? No. I want to get up every day and go to the tree. You're the elves. Meaning us. You throw Hurricane Sandy in here. I must admit, I am genuinely puzzled that Hurricane Sandy and the aftermath helped Obama and hurt Romney. But it did. According to the exit polls. I mean, what they say is what they say. The polls were right on the money, as it turned out. But until people understand why and how big government reduces prosperity for all, they're going to continue to be fooled by little things, by marketing, by smooth talkers, by faux compassion. So we'll see what happens with the economy as we go forward. Now, some people think, hey, Rush, the economy is resilient in this country, and it's going to naturally rebound, no matter what. There are people today scared the economy is going to rebound despite what's happening in the stock market today, and Obama's policies are going to get credit for it. Bunch of libs salivating over that. They think the economy is going to come back no matter what, and that Obama's big government is going to end up being the explanation for the rest of our lives as to how that happened. Just like in Japan, just like in Greece, just like, but look, you bring up Greece and you bring up Europe, they're where we're headed. Their problems are acute. The difference is that none of those European countries are anywhere near the leading economy of the world like we are. The world depends on what happens here. The world does not depend on what happens in Spain or Greece or Italy, and not to put them down. But regardless, wherever you go, look at Greece. Whenever necessary austerity measures are proposed, what happens? No, you don't. You're not taking it away from me. There is no rising to responsibility. There is no accepting response. There's just a demand that the gravy train continue. And we have an administration that's promising an endless gravy train. And all you have to do is stay on that gravy train is vote. But it doesn't matter. The thing that's mind-boggling is that there is no new prosperity in America. There is no improved standard of living. It's all going down. But Obama cares. He really cares. Cares much more than Romney. He really, really cares. In fact, he cares so much, we're going to give him a do-over. We're going to give him a second term to do what we know he wanted to do in the first term but wasn't able to for whatever reason. We'll take a brief timeout. We'll come back. We'll continue. L. Rushbaugh, the EIB Network. Once again, the telephone number, 800-282-2882. The email address, lrushbaugh@eibnet.com.
Nothing but the truth. Rush on the EIB Network. Now America's most scintillating talk show, The Tom Daschle Show.
Tom Daschle!
Hi, and welcome to The Tom Daschle Show. I'm Tom Daschle. Recently, I've experienced some life changes which have allowed me to take the plunge. Yes, I'm now officially a full-time talk radio host, right here on the Internet.
Tom Daschle!
We're simulcasting from our flagship 250-watt powerhouse right here on the reservation in Little Bear. Our trusted engineer tells me that our 2.5-bit streaming audio is sounding great today.
So you shouldn't experience any problems listening today.
I want to go back to the question we've been dealing with. Why did the Democrats lose the election? From Tennessee, it's Al again.
Hello, Tom. You know, I was just thinking this morning, since I came closer to winning in 2000 against George Bush, I'm uniquely qualified to say that if I had chosen to run this time, my semester at Divinity School would have come in pretty handy in dealing with the insurgent evangelicals.
I think that's enough. Everybody knows you flunked out of Divinity School, Al.
I chose to flunk out.
And we're going to choose another caller here. James from Louisiana. Hello, James.
I'm telling you, this party must be born again.
So we should repent of our past evil ways and follow the truth?
No, I wasn't born yesterday. I'm just saying we need a new hula dance with a religious grass skirt.
Oh, I see. Like Jimmy Carter.
I am ready to accept your accolade.
James, you sound...
Do not doubt me.
This caller seems to be on every line.
I'm ready to accept your apologies for doubting me.
Let's go to a break.
Do not doubt me. Sorry, I did it again.
See ya. Let's go to a break. You're listening to Tom...
Tom Daschle!
Daschle right here on the Tom... Daschle Show on the Internet.
Out of the Old West comes a new twist. From the producers of Brokeback Mountain, remakes of your favorite Western classics, destined to be Oscar contenders, like How the West Was Festive, Paint My Wagon,
yeehaw!
And the golden classic, He Wore a Yellow Ribbon.
What, O Chief, can I give you as a token of our friendship?
Me take 'em beads.
Never! They match my hat and my boots!
You'll never forget the boyfriends of Bobby Elder, the magnificent Stephen, or the man who spanked Liberty Valance.
Well, what are you trying to say, Pilgrim?
I want you to be my partner!
Come on, America! Join Hollywood this year as we continue to make fun of ourselves with the first in a series of new Western classics. Watch for them coming soon from the producers of Brokeback Mountain.
Spank me, Liberty! Spank me!
Hey!
Attention Newsweek readers. There's never been a better time to receive or renew your subscription to Newsweek.
Wow, I haven't read that liberal rag in years.
What if we told you about our new amazing subscription offer that not only guarantees you'll have an entire year of Newsweek delivered right to your door, but it also makes you a publishing magnate.
Okay, I'm game.
For only $19.99, you'll receive an entire year of the slightly slanted news coverage, opinion, and interviews you'd expect from Newsweek.
I'm not sold yet.
And by checking our special Buy the Magazine box on the bottom of your subscription card, we'll give you the entire magazine for only $1.
Yeah, I'm getting a year's worth of the magazine.
No, you're taking the entire Newsweek operation, staff, printing press, and our debt.
Newsweek, huh? Hey, you got a deal on Playboy?
For this amazing Newsweek offer, call 1-800-BROKE-RAG. That's 1-800-BROKE-RAG. Newsweek, another failed institution of the liberal media.
We are back. El Rushball, your guiding light through times of trouble, confusion, murkiness, tumult, confusion. None of it makes any sense. None of it makes any sense. Mitt Romney and his wife and his family are the essence of decency. He's the essence of achievement. Mitt Romney's life is a testament to what's possible in this country. Mitt Romney is the nicest guy anybody would ever run into. Mitt Romney is charitable. He wouldn't hurt a fly. He doesn't hate. He's not discriminatory in any way, shape, manner, or form. And no such charges were ever leveled. But what did Romney do? Romney presented a pic. This is very frightening stuff to me. He presented a picture of the traditional view, the traditional roots, the traditional way things work in this country. And part of his camp, there was an assumption, I think, that that's what most people were looking for and a return to. Instead, we've got the Mulligan presidency. We're going to give Obama a do-over. They're going to give him a do-over so that he can do in the second term what we all hoped he would do in the first term. There's nobody singing Obama's praises in terms of achievement. There's nobody singing his praises in terms of good job. They're singing his praises as it relates to marketing, campaigning, strategizing, getting out of the... All that matters, it clearly does. This is not sour grapes on that. Campaigns matter. A lot of things were illustrated and confirmed. Campaigns do matter. Strategy matters. All that stuff matters. But for many of us, the country is at a point where it's never been in our lifetimes, economically. We figured we had one chance to stop this direction, to reverse it, take it back to the traditional path of American greatness. It's rejected. That America is not desired. That America is not wanted. It's difficult to accept that. It's a challenge that we'll have to meet in reclaiming it.
And now, Andy Griffith for Obamacare.
1965, a lot of good things came out that year, like Medicare. And now we got us Obamacare. Mm-mm. And this year, just like always, you're going to have your guaranteed benefits right up until the time you get sick. So all you old angry white folks out there joining the tea parties and protesting and all, just calm down and be a good cracker. Good crack. Tell them the new rules, Barney.
Well, you see, it's like this. Here in Washington, everybody has to play by the rules. And we've developed a rule book just for you there at home. 62,528 new rules to help you through the process of health care in an orderly, organized fashion. Rule number one. There are no peanut butter and jelly sandwiches allowed in any hospital, day or night, 24-7, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Rule number two, if any named insured of a qualified plan gets sick, he or she must fill out request form 24-7.
For more information on Obamacare and how it affects those 65 and older, just get sick and you'll find out. Do you know how much is too much?
Hit me again.
Do you know when to say when?
Pelosi's coming over. Make it a double.
Studies show that those who overindulge exhibit signs of arrogance.
I don't count my drinks because I'm the president.
Overconfidence.
This is the day we stop the seas from rising. Or was it yesterday?
The inability to think clearly on one's own.
Where is my teleprompter? I gotta talk to those kindergarten kids.
You think you're funny, but no one else does.
Let's give the Dalai Lama a set of cufflinks and send him out the back door.
Mr. President, let's don't do that.
And a profound inability to listen to others.
Lama's funny. You don't know funny.
If a friend, relative, or leader of the free world exhibits any of these warning signs, don't let them drive, operate heavy machinery, or sign any important documents.
Where's that health care bill?
And consider moderating their alcohol intake before it's too late. Now, Albert Gore Jr. with one more way you can save the planet.
Instead of driving, try riding your bicycle to work and simplify your life. If only one in five Americans did this, we would save 196 billion barrels of oil every day. Ride a bike created from recycled metal from a manufacturer that uses at least 50% solar or wind power. Instead of air, try filling your tires with CO2 by blowing them up with your lips, like a balloon, trapping this dangerous greenhouse gas. Don't forget to reduce your use of harmful plastics by going seatless. You'll be surprised at the results of taking plastic out of your carbon footprint. Be sure and wear proper earth-friendly attire. Create your own hand-knitted shorts from discarded dryer lint, gathered from the dumpster behind your local washateria. Create nifty sandals from newspaper and rubber bands and twist ties and pieces of string that you find along.
You're over time. We need to cut.
We can't cut it anymore. I won't have time to tell them how to simplify their life.
All of our lives, ladies and gentlemen, what have we heard when it comes to presidential elections? It's the economy, it's the economy, it's the economy. We haven't had, in my lifetime, I've not lived in a worse economy than this one. This should have been a slam dunk, but it wasn't. There are reasons why. We're going to have to dig deep to find them, and we're going to have to be honest with ourselves when we find the answers to this. I keep, I'm reading a bunch of stuff that bloggers and conservative analysts are saying. One of the popular theories is, well, you know, they still can't discount this historical nature. He's the first African-American president, and the American people felt sorry for him. They just want to give him a second chance. They just couldn't bring themselves to vote against him. That the next time, Rush, the Democrats aren't going to have that kind of hold on anybody. They're not going to have that kind of attachment to people and blah, blah. Look, I'm in favor of optimism as much as the next guy, but we are living in the midst of the Democrat Party transforming this country. I don't deny and I don't doubt that race is a central factor in what happened, but it is not the sole explanation. There are additional substantive reasons. You can't minimize the woman in Cleveland. Obama phone. He give us a phone. Obama phone. You realize, do not underestimate the importance of what I am saying. A misunderstanding or disagreement or what have you of what creates prosperity in this country. There are clearly now two schools of thought on that. There used to not be much of an argument about it. Even you go back not that long ago, Democrats used to talk about hard. Even last night, Obama's talking about hard. He doesn't mean it. In his acceptance campaign speech last night, which was more of a campaign speech than acceptance speech, I believe you're black, brown, gay, no matter who you love, if you're this or that. He went through every surface definition of a human being that he could think of. And it's, if you work hard, you got a fair shake, you can get that. So everybody's cheering it. The fact of the matter is the people gathered at McCormick Place last night do not believe that. They do not think they have a fair shake. They have been educated, maleducated, ill-educated. They don't believe they've got a fair shake. They think the deck is stacked against them. They think the Democrat Party corrects that. They think the Democrat Party is going to punish the people who have unfairly gotten stuff that they shouldn't have. They got more stuff than other people have stuff, and that stuff's got to be redistributed. That's the sad reality here. There isn't a work ethic in this country anymore that's universal. Get a college education, and that means magic is supposed to happen for a lot of people. And yet, if it doesn't, if you don't get stuff, if you don't get success that they tell you you're going to get if you do these things, then the game's rigged. Hard work is sneered at. Suggesting that somebody go get a job is reacted to in many places. Oh, easy for you to say. You've got one. And I want to go back to the Republican convention again. I want to ask these questions. I want you all thinking about this. Because it's being said once again that the Republicans have an outreach problem. That we don't have Hispanics, and we don't have blacks, and we don't have women, and we don't have... And it's okay, fine, we don't. What are we supposed to do? Are we supposed to embrace amnesty? No, I'm asking these... Snurdly's in there laughing at, but I'm being serious with this. We have achieved brilliant, highly accomplished African Americans, blacks, Hispanics, you name it, throughout the Republican Party. They serve in office. Many of them are CEOs. It doesn't count. It doesn't count in the media. It doesn't count the Democrat Party. It doesn't count with Obama voters. About whom it is said that stuff matters most. It doesn't count. Why not? Why, putting it somewhat coarsely, why doesn't the Republican Party get credit for Condoleezza Rice? Why doesn't the Republican Party get credit for Marco Rubio? Why doesn't the Republican Party get credit for Suzanne Martinez? How is it that Michelle Bachmann, a highly achieved woman, barely ekes out re-election, and Jesse Jackson Jr. at the Mayo Clinic, going through everything he's going through, wins in a landslide? And I could throw these options, these examples up to you all afternoon. Why don't those people, why don't the Marco Rubios, the Alan Wests? What a great man. What a great American, Alan West. What a great role model. Clarence Thomas. Herman Cain. None of it counts. Don't tell me the Republican Party doesn't have outreach. We do. But what are we supposed to do now? We supposed to, in order to get the Hispanic or Latino vote, does that mean open the borders and embrace the illegals? Is that what, no, I want you to think about this. Is that what it means? Is that what the Republican establishment, so we got to reach out to Hispanics? Is that what they mean? If we're not getting the female vote, do we become pro-choice? Do we start passing out birth control pills? Is that what we have to do? Okay, let me ask you, if that's what we have to do, pretend that we're doing it. Pretend that in the next couple of weeks, couple of months, the Republican Party announces that it is for contraception being paid for by the state, and in fact, the Catholic Church must give contraception away and make abortion available. Are we going to get the votes that Obama got last night? We're not? Really? We're not? We won't. But we're not getting the votes that Obama got last night because we have Condoleezza Rice, and she is pinnacle of achievement and intelligent, well-spoken. I mean, you can't find a more accomplished, better person, Condoleezza Rice, Marco Rubio. And really speaking in just street lingo, we're not getting credit for it. Now, is it that Republicans are looking for credit and it's not perceived as genuine? Are these people all viewed as tokens? And the white Republican establishment is just putting these people out front, but they really don't believe that Marco Rubio's that good a deal or that Condi? Are they just window dressing? If that's so, if that's the perception of the Obama voters, then how do we change that? What do you mean you don't? Well, if you look at these exit polls, if we don't change that, we're not going to win elections. According to the exit polls, there's one option that still hasn't been tried in a long time. It's called conservatism with a capital C. It still hasn't been tried. This was not a conservative campaign. It was a good campaign. It was a mid-range, and I don't want anybody misunderstanding me here, but because I think Mitt Romney is one of the best people, human beings, I've ever met. I have no quarrel with Mitt Romney, and I'm not going to be one to dump on Romney. Everybody can do Monday morning quarterbacking and so forth. We all have our, like, for example, when I heard Romney in the last 2 weeks talking about reaching across the aisle, I cringed, but I'm not going to come here and introduce negativism because I'm not going to change him. What I say on the air is not going to change Romney's approach. They've got their strategists and they got their campaign people figuring out what they want to do. I thought there was a little bit too much assuming going on, too much assumption that people understood what Romney was talking about when he starts talking about the economy. But I'm telling you, we're going to have to go back and redefine how prosperity happens in this country. And conservatism and the Constitution are the best way to do this. Are we, youth. We need the youth vote. Are we... I'll tell you what, let's do. Let's, as the Republican Party, let's announce, say around Christmas time, so that we can get as close to being Santa Claus ourselves. Let's announce that we are for the legalization of marijuana, and that as a party, we believe in forgiving all student loans. Let's beat Obama to the punch. You know, Obama runs the student loan program. Well, let's go get the youth vote. And is that how we would do it? Okay, so where is the obvious? The answer is no. The answer, all these objections of these examples I've given you, Latinos, we're not going to get the Latino vote by opening the borders and saying that, you know what, let anybody in who wants to come in. But there's some Republicans who think we have to. Keep a sharp eye. Women. Let's start our own abortion industry. Let's go out and get the women's vote. The point is, I just want you to think, would that work? In this America today, would that work? It does for the Democrats. every Obama voter may not be religious, but they believe in Santa Claus. And you know what else they believe about Santa Claus? If Santa Claus doesn't judge anybody, you're going to get your stuff no matter how you behave. You're going to get your stuff whether you're a good guy, a bad guy, or a non-entity. Santa Claus isn't judgmental. In fact, Santa Claus loves you because you have the deck stacked against you. The Democrat Party has made every one of their voters, other than the elite professors and the Hollywood types ought to know better, think they're members of victims or victim groups. And that they have no way to achieve prosperity in the traditional way. That deck is stacked against them by people like us, they think. So government's got to come in and make it fair. And that's cool, by the way. That's hip. That's cool. Got to take a break here, folks. You sit tight. We'll come back. I think, well, squeeze a phone call or two in when we get back. So don't go away.
The state-controlled media stops here. Rush on the EIB network. Now a message from President Barack Obama on how he plans to help Americans cope with higher gasoline prices.
My fellow Americans, I'm sure that you, like most Americans, are feeling pinched economically by higher gas prices at the pump. Recent political events in the Middle East have destabilized oil-producing nations, disrupting supply, raising prices, and calling into question America's dependence on foreign oil. As president, I would have preferred a gradual adjustment, but I can't do anything about the high cost of gasoline. But you can buy the all-new Chevrolet Volt, Government Motors' first full-production electric car for just under $50,000. Consumer Reports said it was the only electric car that GM makes, and that it was capable of going up to 28 miles in the snow. And you can extend that range by taking along an optional 400-pound second battery.
Yes, you can buy an electric car that's slow, fuel-efficient, American-made, and more expensive than a Toyota Prius, even after a $7,500 tax credit.
The Chevrolet Volt. Last month we sold over 281. Who knows how many more we'll sell if gas prices reach an optimum of, say, $15 a gallon.
The Chevrolet Volt. Buy here, buy now.
Is your terror cell living in terror?
Now this word from the New York Times to jihadists everywhere.
Is your safe house not that safe? If you want your sleeper cell to sleep safely, read the New York Times.
Jihadists everywhere depend on the New York Times.
I saved my sleeper cell thanks to the New York Times.
For information you can't get anywhere else.
Did you know your phone calls are traced? Did you know your money transfers are being intercepted?
No, thanks to the New York Times, you will be safe and secure.
I rerouted my terror funds thanks to the New York Times.
From Tora Bora to Tijuana, terrorists everywhere depend on the New York Times.
Because you'll find all the secret stuff that makes news meaningful to you.
Plus, exciting bonus features.
Daily attacks on the infidels by Maureen O'Dowd and Paul Al-Krugman and Tom Al-Friedman. Not to mention the entire front page of our newspaper, which is Daily Attacks on the Infidels.
Gift subscriptions available.
We offer at the New York Times quantity discounts for large terror cells, educational discounts for madrasas and terrorist training camps. Read the New York Times and your sleeper cell can sleep safe.
Even in the deepest, darkest cave, you'll be the first to get inside knowledge of what the infidels have in mind to wipe you out.
New York Times, The Infidels, Jihad Journal.
Now, a message of fairness.
So I got a note today. I got a note from a friend who said, Rush, you know, you're really on the right track here in this prosperity business. Just be patient, because when people see that unemployment isn't getting better, more will question what they believe about Obama's policies working. Where's the evidence to believe that? Where is the evidence that people are going to associate a dismal economy with Obama? Over half of them still blame George W. Bush. And how, by the way, was that permitted to happen? That's a whole nother discussion. How in the world does that stick? That the economy, after 4 years of specific Obama policies that have damaged the economy, how is it that every Obama voter blames Bush, including their elites, including their smarter than everybody else professors, including their smarter than everybody else Hollywood, that they believe that? As well as their rank and file voters, they believe it. It doesn't hurt that Obama continues to blame you. In our America, it is unpresidential to act like a baby and blame your predecessor. In our America, you man up. You take responsibility. You face problems head on and you try to fix them. The sad reality is that there is no attempt to fix what's going wrong in this country. And by blaming George W. Bush for it, Obama is given carte blanche to continue his policies of damage. Obama is hell-bent on remaking this country. We're in the middle of it. We're 4 years into a transformation of this government becoming statist. It really is. Liberty versus tyranny. We're 4 years into tyranny winning. And guess what? No matter what happens now, it's Bush's fault. Obama's getting a mulligan. Obama's getting a do-over. Over half the people that voted, that's how they're looking at it. It's not theory anymore. That's the reality we face. The reality we face is that what's real isn't. And what isn't real is. Well, you are free to disagree with me on this. I welcome it. I'd love to be talked out of this. We have to face facts, folks. We have to, if a hurricane can literally end a presidential campaign or destroy it or do unfixable damage, A, the hurricane arrives. B, the president shows up for 2 hours, then lets a photo out in a situation where he's apparently studying it. I know, you can't throw the Chris Christie thing out. That's major. If we're dealing with an electorate that can be moved by something genuinely as meaningless in substantive terms as that, then we're living in the brave new world. And we've been trending in this direction. Symbolism over substance. Bill Clinton, hello, thank you very much. You know what? I didn't get that phone call in. I honestly intended to, folks. I really did. I really meant to get a phone call in here. But when you make as much sense as I do, you just keep going. So I apologize. We'll get...
He didn't start it, but he'll be happy to finish it. Rush on the EIB Network.
New from Republican Pictures, Citizen McCain, the true-to-life story of a senator who was willing to go across the aisle.
Senator, Senator, when are you coming back?
Legendary were the accomplishments of John Foster McCain, a solid Republican senator, except for campaign finance reform, illegal immigration, tax cuts, Guantanamo.
You forgot global warming.
Having lost in his first bid for the presidency, he wins his party's nomination in 2008 with a new tactic.
I am today what I have always been, a conservative.
Citizen McCain, starring the veteran actor, director John McCain, star of such memorable films as The McCain Mutiny, The Gang of 14, and the popular C-SPAN TV series, Maverick.
I don't care if I am the only Republican in this town to vote with Ted Kennedy. He's right.
A potent figure in the media who held dominion over the Senate, McCain is somewhat cautious on the campaign trail.
I believe that the policies of Rosebud are...
Rosebud? What does he mean, Rosebud?
He can't bring himself to say Barack Hussein Obama. Doesn't want to offend anyone.
Citizen McCain, playing everywhere! Until the first Tuesday in November.
And now, Saving the World with Al Gore Jr.
Hello, this is Albert Gore Jr. And as I said in the New York Times, I, for one, genuinely wish that the climate crisis were an illusion. But unfortunately, the reality of the danger we are courting has not been changed by the discovery of at least two very small mistakes in the thousands of pages of careful scientific research. Small mistakes happen every day. Ask Charlie Rangel. He went on vacation and had no idea who was paying for it. Nancy Pelosi thought it was okay to fly friends and family and associates to Washington and to Copenhagen so that they could be near her. Honest mistakes happen all the time. Ask Governor Patterson, who sent a couple of state troopers to a woman's house to deliver a Hallmark card of sympathy, and it was mistakenly caught up in the press as some sort of threat. Well, I say all that to say this, that honest mistakes are made every day by Democrats everywhere. What's a few degrees in temperature either way? Cut me some slack.
Join us next time as we once again save the world with Al Gore Jr. Most Americans think that elite...
The Associated Press said that this nation is more racist today than it was in 2008. AP, that's been a theme of theirs. We're more racist today, 2008, yet we just gave the first African-American president a mulligan. We just gave him a do-over. What a racist nation this is. Oh, man.
Who can say that nothing's yours and suddenly take it from you with style? It's Elizabeth and you will know it. When she's in the Senate, she's sure to show it. Money's all around, no need to waste it. Lizzie Warren's right, we should just take it. You didn't make it on your own. Nobody makes it on their own. You used a road or bridge, or like Solyndra just got alone. Well, it's not yours and you should know it. Government creates jobs, it's time to grow it. Money's all around, no need to waste it. Your success is ours, why don't you face it? Make it on your own. You didn't make it on your own.
Now a message from Peter, People for the Ethical Treatment of Rodents.
People of DC, you said it was time to stop the killing in the streets, and we listened.
With the passage of the Wildlife Act of 2010, pest control companies will finally have to behave humanely toward our rodent brothers by using only capture and relocate tactics. No longer will they be allowed to discriminate against the rice rat and the deer mouse just because they could spread typhoid and 70 other known diseases. To complete the circle of life, licensed pest control companies must move only intact families to better neighborhoods in Maryland and Virginia. Because our rodent brothers may evolve at any time to a higher form of life than ourselves, let us all work together now to promote peace and understanding between our species. Remember, rodents are people too.
No, he's not kidding. This is an actual message from Peter, People for the Ethical Treatment of Rodents.
Now a message from the Memphis City Schools.
My fellow Memphians, be sure to sign up your kids for the free supper and midnight snack program at the Memphis City Schools this fall, and pick them up next May if you still recognize them. Memphis is America's fifth most obese city in the world, but we don't have to be. Let's go to the top of the charts with a balanced Memphis diet of barbecue pork ribs, pulled pork, pork chops, banana pudding, and butter. Yeah. Wait, what's this?
Apple slices.
What the hell can we do with that? Yeah, I know. 5 minutes in the microwave, half a stick of butter, cinnamon sugar, and ice cream. Yeah, sounds good. So if you're all shook up about fixing your kid one meal a day, drop them off here at the Memphis City Schools and spend them food stamps on yourself.
Celebrity voice impression performed by celebrity voice impressionist. President Obama is not the Messiah and did not raise Elvis from the dead.
This message brought to you by the SEIU. Fixing breakfast, lunch, dinner, and assorted snacks for your children 24/7. Thank you. Thank you very much.
It's the biggest movie of the summer. The greatest Western to hit the silver screen in years. The Moderate Seven. From out of the West came a bold maverick leader of six Republican moderates.
Saddle up, boys and girls. We're burning daylight, and we've got a long way to go.
Seven moderates willing to take on the forces of evil in Washington.
John, who's he talking about?
Our party, Lindsay.
Who?
The Republicans.
You mean we're going to fight each other?
I'll explain later. Let's ride!
Feel the tension as they meet in secret with old Chief Silverbird.
I am pleased that you have come to powwow with me.
Oh, great chief. What can we do to make peace with your people?
Much wampum. First, lay down all of your weapons. Then bend over and grab your ankles as a sign of bipartisanship. And I, Chief Silverbird, we'll release 3 hostages and scalp all the rest.
It's a deal.
The Moderate Seven, the boldest moderate movie ever. Check listings for showtimes. In the past, people who suffered from restless leg syndrome were thought to be unable to lead a healthy, productive life. But here at the Restless Leg Institute, we've helped literally thousands of victims of restless leg syndrome become independent and go on to live happy, successful, productive lives, like Rachel here. Her tap lessons have really changed things, opening doors to many opportunities she would have missed. Or take Matthew here. By riding the stationary bicycle equipped with a 200,000 kilowatt generator, Matthew provides a safe, clean, alternative energy source to the Institute and 32 surrounding homes. Are you tired yet, son?
No, sir!
Graduates from the Institute include Pele, Elvis Presley, and the entire cast of Riverdance. So if you or someone you know suffers from restless leg syndrome, tell them about the Restless Leg Institute before it's too late.
Attention drivers, truckers, RV owners.
You enjoy driving and talking on your handheld cell phone, but don't want a ticket? Then you need the Burger and Fry Stealth Cell Phone from Crapco. The phone comes disguised as a lifelike plastic hamburger bun. Add the condiments of your choice for added realism. Stick the included wireless French fry in your ear. Then drive and chat the miles away. And in case you're pulled over by the man.
All right, Mac, you're getting a ticket for driving while using a handheld cell phone.
But, officer, I wasn't on the phone. I was just eating my burger and fries.
Oh, well, that's different. Here, you need a napkin.
Why, thank you, officer.
Plus, each Crapco Burger and Fries Stealth cell phone has a lifetime warranty just in case you ever have to eat
it. Hey, that's not one of those Crapco phones, is it? Let me see you take a bite out of that bun.
Sure.
Simply recover the residue and send it to us for a complete refund. The revolutionary Crapco Burger and Fries Stealth Cell Phone.
Onions, pickles, ketchup, mustard, mayonnaise, and sesame seeds not included.
greetings, my friends, and welcome back. Great to have you, Rush Limbaugh, and the Excellence in Broadcasting Network, still the nation's most listened to radio talk show. And I've offered my chair today to anybody who wants to sit in it. And nobody does. I've offered the opportunity to speak to 50 million people, and nobody wants to sit in this chair. I'm happy to do it. Great to have you, folks. As always, here's the telephone number. It's 800-282-2882. Email address, lrushbaugh@eibnet.com. We have to face some truths. We have to face some reality. We are outnumbered, and we are losing ground. This was not a glitch. This is the trend that happened last night. This is the trend. We are outnumbered. Whether you want to put it in terms of have we lost the country or not, there's no other explanation. I don't care if there are more Republicans that didn't vote. Why didn't they? I don't want to talk about the people that didn't vote. That just means we didn't get our vote out. I don't want to talk about election strategy. I want to talk about the results. You have to face them. We are outnumbered. We're losing ground. It's difficult to beat Santa Claus. I'm just going to give a brief review here of the first hour. It's impossible to beat Santa Claus, especially when your alternative is that you have to be your own Santa Claus. We have totally allowed the understanding of what creates wealth and what creates prosperity in this country be distorted. We have allowed it to be misdefined, redefined. We have allowed wealth and achievement to become negatives. We have permitted prosperity, hard work, to become things that are sneered at and said to be not for everybody. We've allowed this. It's been happening. And we have said, all the while it's been going on, the American people are never going to believe that stuff. But the left has been relentless for decades pushing this. I also want to rephrase, restate a couple of questions from the first hour. Because there's all kind of Monday morning quarterbacking going on. I'm not doing that. I'm telling you what is. And, of course, predictable voices on the Republican side. Well, we're going to have to get serious now about Hispanic outreach. And we have to get serious now about reaching out to women. And we have to get serious about reaching out to the youth vote. We have to get serious. Okay, what does that mean? Let's go to our convention. We put forth some of the most accomplished minorities this country has to offer. We have the Republican Party has more elected Hispanics serving in office than the Democrat Party has. And yet, what is said about Republicans? Racists, sexists, bigots, homophobes that discriminate and so forth. Why does putting Condoleezza Rice front and center at the convention not work? Why does putting Marco Rubio front and center at the convention not work? Why does putting Suzanne Martinez, the governor of New Mexico, front and center convention not work? Why does putting Mia Love, who sadly lost one of the most accomplished, achieved, decent people in this country, she's African-American, she's running for the House in Utah, she's the mayor of Saratoga Springs. She lost. Not only are we trying to get credit for it, is it seen as disingenuous? Do people not believe that really we like Condoleezza Rice? We're just throwing her out there. She's a token. They must. It doesn't work. It doesn't help us with the African-American vote. In fact, back when she was Secretary of State, look at what liberal cartoonists got away with their caricatures of her. Aunt Jemima, Step and Fetch It. They did cartoons caricaturing every racial, physical stereotype. They treated her like an animal. And Alan West, a decorated man of the United States Army, a hero, member of Congress from here, down in South Florida. One of the most achieved, accomplished, decent human beings. Look at how he's treated. Look at Clarence Thomas. Look at how they're all treated by the party supposedly of tolerance, love, and compassion. Every minority or woman who is a conservative is targeted for destruction. We have done the reach out. We have done everything they, quote unquote, say we should do to show that we're not just the white guy's party. Why doesn't it work, folks? Serious question. Why doesn't it work? Is it seen as not genuine? Is it seen as tokenism? Is it seen as what? Everything about these people's real. She was Secretary of State. She was the provost of Stanford. She was. This is key. Every one of these people that I'm talking about that had a prominent role at our convention had something in common. The traditional American story, up from nothing. Parents who sacrificed and gave up a lot so that their kids could be something. Sneered at. Laughed at. Didn't count. Doesn't work. Look at what happened to Mitt Romney. Mitt Romney, one of the most decent... It's impossible to exaggerate what a great man Mitt Romney is, what a great family he has, how great he would have been at this time for this country. It's impossible to exaggerate it. And yet, the people that voted for Barack Obama believe he allowed a man's wife to die. Because he didn't care. They believe that he is a felon. They believe he's not paying his taxes. The left gets away with every lie, every smear. Why? We are going to have to come up with answers to this. And we are going to have to realize, at the same time, that the antidote to what is happening in this country is happy, confident, full-fledged, unapologetic conservatism. The Republican Party still has not tried it. But that is for another day. But I want to get that out there. Here's Marco Rubio, an excerpt from his statement following the Obama victory. In the next Congress, I am committed to working on upward mobility policies that will ensure people who work hard and play by the rules can rise above the circumstances of their birth and leave their children better off. I'm sorry, the people who voted for Barack Obama aren't interested. That doesn't reach them. Why not? Marco Rubio can write the book on how to achieve prosperity, how to achieve wealth, how to succeed in this country. Why is he rejected? I know he won the election for his sentence, but I mean, his story at the Republican convention. You watch. Rubio's name now vaults to the top of 2016 potentials. You watch and see what the left will start doing to Marco Rubio. And that genuine, traditional American story that is his is going to be impugned, besmirched, criticized, lied about, distorted. Because the one thing the Democrat Party and the one thing the media in this country will not allow to happen is an ideological contest. They will lose every time there is one. I don't correct me if I'm wrong, did at any point in this campaign, did somebody come out and say Obama's a liberal? Did Romney, or did they say that? I if they did, it wasn't very often. Most of it, he's a nice guy. He just, I don't know what he's doing. He's a good guy. He's a good man. He just, I don't know. Sorry, folks, but that's not going to work. Well, Rush, calling him a mean guy, though, because his people love him. Folks, the truth is something that we're losing here. We had better try it at some point. Fear of the truth is only causing us to lose. Fear of the truth is only causing us to be outnumbered. And no truth on Obama's side of this. And no truth to Obama's speech last night. There was no truth in his campaign. There's no truth to what these people believe. They believe in a mirage. They believe in an image. They're voting for Santa Claus. Not only are they voting for Santa Claus, they think they're entitled to a daily visit from Santa Claus. They've been told this country's unfair, unjust, and immoral to them. It always has been. That's Obama's great reach to them. He's the guy that's going to fix all this inequality and all this discrimination and all the disadvantages and all the unfairness that this country has visited upon these various people. He's Santa Claus. What's our message? Yeah, we believe in Santa Claus, too. You're it. Prosperity, you work hard, that's how you achieve it. Oh, gosh, what's the choice? Working hard or getting Obama phone? You're unemployed for 4 years in this country. You have a cell phone, a TV, a car, and you're eating. What's the problem? Seriously, what's the problem? Unless you have an ethic about you, a sense of responsibility to yourself and to your family, a sense of civic duties, is you've got to get a job. And unless you're a person who does not define who you are by virtue of your work or partially by your work, what's the problem? There's your flat screen, there's your phone, there's your 120 free minutes, whatever you get for it, and there's your unemployment compensation bumped up. And your food stamps, what's the problem? These are real circumstances, folks. You can say, well, how you be so unkind and cruel? I'm not. I'm just telling you what is. And we are trending to the... Do you realize that Obama's message is that the people who are making it possible for him to be Santa Claus aren't working hard enough? You realize Obama's message is, not only am I Santa Claus, but the people who are making all this possible still aren't paying their fair share. While you're out there doing nothing, they still aren't paying their fair share. It's not, I'm still going to come out, I'm going to raise their taxes. I'm still going to come in. It's just not right that they had. And you doctors, you're next. When everybody figures out the ultimate damage that Obamacare is going to do to the health industry, to medical care, to insurance, to all this. It won't be long. In fact, it may be happening in various places already. Why should somebody get wealthy for treating the sick? We have an inherent right to good health. We have an inherent right to health care. What does that mean? Health care equals good health. We have a right. Why should somebody get rich? Why? It's not right. It's not fair. Not everybody can be a doctor. Why should they do so well? This is the stuff that's coming. It's all part of resentment. We're all part of the resentment for achievement, for success. So, Rubio. The conservative movement should have particular appeal to people in minority and immigrant communities who are trying to make it. And Republicans need to work harder than ever to communicate our beliefs. That's true. We do need to take a conservative message to them. At the same time, we need to show them it works. We need to show them there is a payoff to hard work. And that oftentimes it's not just financial. There is satisfaction, the sense of achievement, the maximizing of a person. person's potential, being the best you can be, do you realize not one iota of Obama's message is oriented toward greatness or excellence in the individual? It's a wide open opportunity for us. We just have very few people on our side able to articulate it right now, but hopefully that will change. Let's take a break, okay? And I promise your phone calls on the other side. Don't go away.
The wonder of Rush will continue on the EIB Network. What college do you dream of sending your kids to? Yale, Harvard, Princeton?
Forget it. Those are the universities of yesteryear. The school of the future is COC.
Community Organizer College.
I'm a graduate, and I just took control of General Motors. And now I'm thinking of taking over Chrysler, too. Maybe. Or selling it to an Italian bicycle company, I think.
Want your kids to run a giant company? Or even an entire industry, like healthcare, banking, or insurance? Enroll him or her at COC, Community Organizer College.
Do you want your darlings to have trillions of dollars of money to spread around? Apply to Community Organizer College. Our teachings are based on a major breakthrough in education. It's not what you know. It's what people think you know.
At COC, Community Organizer College, we don't waste time teaching English, history, math, science, or business management.
We teach cool. We teach pompous. We teach teleprompter, doublespeak, seducing the media.
Community Organizer College.
Where your kids can learn to run a company or a country. Who knows? Maybe the entire planet.
Community Organizer College. Capacity is limited. Better act now. For an application, dial 1-800-ACORN-COC.
It's not what you know. It's what people think you know.
And now, Andy Griffith for Obamacare.
1965. A lot of good things came out that year, like Medicare. And now we got us Obamacare. This year, just like always, you're going to have your guaranteed benefits right up until the time you get sick. So all you old angry white folks out there joining the tea parties and protesting and all, just calm down and be a good cracker. Good cracker. Tell them the new rules, Barney.
Well, you see, it's like this. Here in Washington, everybody has to play by the rules. And we've developed a rule book just for you there at home. 62,528 new rules to help you through the process of health care in an orderly, organized fashion. Rule number one. There are no peanut butter and jelly sandwiches allowed in any hospital day or night, 24/7, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Rule number two. If any named insured of a qualified plan gets sick, he or she must fill out request form 24/7.
For more information on Obamacare and how it affects those 65 and older, just get sick and you'll find out. Crapital Records presents the newest...
Say what you want, folks. Mitt Romney did offer a vision of greatness, a vision of traditional America, a vision of an American recovery and return to prominence. He did that in his own way. You may not have thought it was the best way to, but he did it in his own way. That's what he was talking about. And it was rejected. It was rejected in favor of a guy who thinks those who are working aren't doing enough to help those who aren't. A question. Hypothetical question. Let's say Mitt Romney won last night. And let's say today that Mitt Romney is out, and he does his press conference, asking about the economy, and he said, well, you know, we really have a much worse mess here because of George Bush than I even thought. Would he get away? Would Mitt Romney be allowed to get away with blaming George Bush? even though Romney hasn't been in charge of anything for 4 years. Would Mitt Romney be allowed to blame Bush? Would Mitt Romney be given a pass? No, he wouldn't have. Barack Obama, after 4 years of destructive, specifically destructive economic policies, is still, it's in the exit polls. Over half of Americans blame Bush. It would never even occur to Mitt Romney to blame a predecessor. And if he tried it, the press would be all over him and wouldn't let him get away with it. The AP, last week, recurring story, America more racist in 2012 than it was in 2008. So much more racist that we're giving the first African-American president who is a failure a mulligan. And according to some in the media, precisely because he's black. That's what a good nation we are. We just, the voters of America just can't bring themselves to say no to the first black president. So, we're going to reward mediocrity. We're going to reward failure. We're going to reward it because that makes us good people. Okay, Ted in Annapolis, Maryland, you're first on the phones, and thank you for waiting. I appreciate that.
Oh, thanks for taking my call, Rush.
You bet.
I agree with everything you're saying, but there's one thing I'm not hearing, and that's also the fear of change, or fear of the hard choices we have as a country. I mean, you know, we got a mess in our economy and the debt we're standing on, and we've got to make choices. Not exactly like Greece, but it's going to be a little bit of pain for everybody, whether it's, you know, the reform of the tax code, or restructuring Medicare. You know, everybody's going to have to put a little bit in. And I think there's some fear in people.
No.
That, you know, I don't want to give it little.
No. For the people who voted for Obama, they aren't going to have to put a little in. There will not be any pain for them. That's what voting for Obama means. Voting for Obama means ending the pain for them. Obama is going to make others feel the pain. Those Obama voters aren't afraid of anything. They're afraid of him losing. Their fear is rooted in Romney's solution to our problem, which is, you know what, we're going to have to put people back to work. American hard work and ingenuity, that's what they don't want to hear. That's what scares them. Obama washes away their fear. Everybody else is going to have to do it, not them. That's the message. He's Santa Claus. It's the rich that aren't paying their fair share. The rich that are going to have to pay a little bit more. It's the rich that didn't build that. Obama's people, they built everything necessary for the rich to get rich, and then the rich aren't sharing enough of it. But now they will. That's what voting for Obama means.
Now a word from the National Keep Our Own Kids Safe campaign about the danger of soccer.
If they have a competitive player on the field that they can't beat, they're coached to hurt them and take them out of the game.
Keep Our Own Kids Safe national celebrity spokesman Rush Limbaugh.
At what age is that taught?
Fairly young.
That is the entirely different picture from what I have always thought soccer was. I thought soccer was a refuge from violence. I thought that's one of the drawing cards of soccer, and that parents were sending their kids out there so they wouldn't get involved in those kinds of activities.
Well, that's exactly why we had our boys play soccer. This same son went to college on a soccer scholarship, and he thought he would get away from this being attacked. In a tournament game, he again won the ball, and the kid he won it from ran wide open at him, lunged at him with his knee up and got him in the groin and shattered a testicle. They left him laying on the side of the field during that game, and he went into shock.
This is a genuine horror story that I'm sure pains you to tell. I think it's important to point out that the soccer moms obviously didn't know and don't know. It's not that they were irresponsible or are irresponsible like Jane here. They were just uninformed. This is why our education campaign is so important.
Join Rush Limbaugh and help support the Keep Our Own Kids Safe campaign. Look for the Keep Our Own Kids Safe chapter near you.
You'll find them everywhere.
Ladies and gentlemen, a message to all our servicemen and women from your Commander-in-Chief, President Barack Obama.
For far too long, we've given medals and citations for strength and bravery in battle, ignoring those who didn't fire their weapon or attempt to achieve their objective. Let me be clear. From this day forward, that will change.
Introducing the Yellow Heart, an historic new presidential medal awarded posthumously for restraint in combat.
The Yellow Heart symbolizes my administration's attitude of fair play on the battlefield, no matter what the cost.
And there's so much more. Now, if you desert your unit, you'll receive the AWOL Ribbon of Peace. And for treacherous behavior beyond the call of Allah, you'll learn the works and plays well with the enemy, knife in the back with gold leaf.
Take it from me, John F. Kerry. I was in Vietnam, and I wouldn't throw these over a fence for the world.
The Presidential Medal Collection. Combat medals for everyone. Do you have trouble being taken seriously?
How did you know?
Do you long for that certain special something lacking in your voice?
Uh-huh.
Do you want to make your average thoughts and ideas seem powerful and gifted?
Yeah.
Well, now you can have that confident, authoritative, God-like sound wherever you go with the Obamatron Verberator Pro. The Obamatron Verberator Pro is the only portable reverberation device personally endorsed by Barack Obama because it's so simple to use. Just implant the tiny sensor.
Wait.
And you can set your Verberator Pro for any occasion. Choose from stately.
Wow, that is different. I feel so presidential.
I come before you today to ask you for one of those tiny umbrellas for my drink.
Canyon.
Hello. 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 Hello.
And for large egos, Der Führermeister.
I have led the accounting department to new and greater heights.
This holiday season, give the gift that no one can forget, the Obamatron Verberator Pro. The Verberator Pro is not for everybody on your list.
Some enchanted evening, you will see a stranger
and may become annoying after a short period of time.
Looking good, huh? I'm talking about me.
Let's look at this. Women and Latinos, Hispanics, and young skulls full of mush all came in big for Obama, and his policies are crushing them, particularly in terms of unemployment. But it didn't matter. Obama's female unemployment, all-time high in this country. But they're going to get their birth control pills. Who would have ever believed, you know, so Tucker Carlson last night on Fox, he was talking about radio ads Obama was running in Pennsylvania, all on abortion. Single women in this country were actually moved to vote for Obama because they thought Romney's going to take abortion away from them. They're actually made to believe that. Romney couldn't. There's no president who can. That doesn't matter. I got to take the chance. The truth and reality and the Constitution doesn't matter. Stunning. You have Obama's policies are crushing women, young people. Look at student loan debt. Look at the lack of jobs. Look at the cost of college tuition. Obama's making everything worse. These people show up in droves. Why? Ditto Hispanics and their unemployment. And he didn't even come through for them on immigration. And they still showed up. Why? Women voted Obama 55 to 43 for Romney. Massive gender gap. Unchanged from 2008. Unmarried women backed Obama 68% to 30%. They thought Romney's going to take away their birth control pills. Obama treats them like vaginas, and they say, he's my man. Go figure. Obama won the Ute vote, 24-point margin. Overall turnout of young voters was up over 2008. Even the Democrats thought it was going to be down. 71% Latino vote for Obama. That's the worst any Republican has gotten since modern polling began. And it's a growing Democrat. 71% of Latino votes. So what are we to do? Do we come out for amnesty and illegal immigration now? Is that how we get them? I'm asking. I'm not being rhetorical. Do we start passing out birth control pills? I'm asking, not rhetorically. I mean, this is what it said the Democrats are doing to get their votes. So what do? People who think this way and vote this way outnumber us now, folks. And we are losing ground. And we have a political party that's more than happy to capitalize on this, however you want to characterize these people. Their lack of knowledge, their fear, their susceptibility to being victim, whatever you want to say. The Democrat Party is more than willing to destroy the traditions and institutions that have defined this nation's greatness. Doesn't matter what it takes. Doesn't matter what they end up doing to people's lives. Because at the end of it, they're all going to have a phone, a TV set, a car, and 120 free minutes, and food stamps. No matter how bad it gets, they're going to be able to watch TV and eat and get around and text their buddies. It used to be when you were unemployed, that stuff came to screeching halt, including eating. Isaac, Spring Valley, New York. Great to have you on the EIB Network. Hello.
Yes, hello, Rush. How are you?
Very well, sir. Thanks for the call.
I can agree with you more. But one thing, just to put into perspective, is that last night we were telling people, basically the Democrats, to stand up, to take responsibility, and throw out a guy of office. And I think people won't make that choice when they already have a guy. And we would have had a better chance if it would have been Romney against Obama in 08.
It's my hearing. I'm not sure that I got it. You say we were telling people that the Democrat. What, say that again? What were we telling?
I mean, we were telling people to like stand up and take responsibility and take and start cutting back on taxes and deficits. And we were telling people also to throw out a president. So those two things were going against the odds. And I do think we would have had a much better opportunity if we would have been in the first term.
Well, and let me see if I understand. What you're saying is that it's a tough thing to tell people, hey, stand up, take responsibility for yourself. That's a tough sell. That's my point. Santa Claus, or that. And then your point is, at the same time we're doing that, we're asking them to throw away Santa Claus. Is that what you're saying? Correct.
And one more thing, Rush. Can I make another point?
Yeah.
We just got to thank you last night. I just can't imagine how much more I got to thank you, because there is a changing tide in the country, turning liberal, and the only thing that protected us, that we still have 49 people coming out, 49 million people voting for Romney, was you, and you were exposing conservatism and preaching them, and I think that's the only hope that why we're still around.
Well, I appreciate your saying that. I do appreciate you saying that, but there are certainly additional reasons beyond me. I mean, people are what they are. I mean, this nation still has a tremendous number of patriots, still has a tremendous number of just traditional, good-hearted, decent Americans. They don't need me to be that way. They are. But I appreciate your kind words. I really do. You know, I watched, I was up late last night, like maybe most of you. I watched Sarah Palin. She was on with Greta late. You know what? I'd say she was right on the money. She could not believe what had happened. I mean, we just elected somebody that's destroying the domestic energy sector of this country. We just, it's, and the things that she thought would magically work, energy independence, drill for our own oil, become independent from foreign sources, and therefore tumult and chaos in the Middle East, other parts of the world where we get oil, didn't matter. And there's a reason why it doesn't matter. Because no matter what, Obama's going to make sure they've got gas, unless there's a hurricane. But all he has to do then is go out and get bear hugged by one of the most so-called partisan Republicans in the country. And look, he's bipartisan president. He really does want to work with the other side. There's one Republican that's nice and wants to work with him. And he goes back, he's in 2 hours max on the ground and gets full credit for caring and fixing it. What is this going to do to Chris Christie? I don't know yet. I don't know what it's going to do to Chris Christie. And I don't think anybody else at this point knows what the long-term effects are going to be. Because there will be other events that are going to happen that will give him a chance to fix it or make it worse. Well, let me just ask you. Have you seen anybody in the media, or and I haven't, but I might have missed it, and I'm asking because I generally want to. Have you seen anybody blaming Christie for Romney losing? I'm seeing them blame the hurricane. I am seeing them blame the hurricane for destroying Romney's momentum. But are you seeing any Republicans or anybody in the media blame Christie for, well, yeah, well, conversations everywhere where it's unforgivable what he did. Yeah, but that's something that we don't know. Time will tell on that. I appreciate the call. Thanks again very much. And we'll be right back. Don't go away.
Somebody has to have the guts to say it. Rush on the EIB Network. Welcome to How Gullible Are You? Now, with today's questions, here's your genial host, Rush Limbaugh.
Did you believe Bill Clinton when he said, I did not have sex with that woman, not a single time, ever? I never asked anybody to lie. Did you believe Bill Clinton? Did you believe Bob Torricelli when he denied all the things he had to leave the Senate for? Did you believe David Axelrod when he said Obama and Blagojevich discussed his Senate replacement? Did you believe Obama's Axelrod when he said he misspoke about Obama and Blagojevich having that discussion? Did you believe Jesse Jackson Jr. when he said he met with Blagojevich for 90 minutes and pay to play never came up? When Obama said things will get better, did he mean it? Or did he misspeak?
Now, let's see how you scored with How Gullible Are You?
If you answered yes to all five, you are a liberal for life, or you are a drive-by journalist. If you answered yes to two or three of these questions, you are a moderate. And there remains hope for you if you remain a regular attendee at classes here at the Limbaugh Institute. If you answered no to all five, you are grounded in reality and are thus cursed, because you will be forever hounded, frustrated, and driven to near insanity by the gullible, who did pass this test.
Join us next time for How Gullible Are You? This has been an EIB production. Want to lead an environmentally friendly lifestyle, but your SUV and powerboat get in the way? Introducing the EIB Carbon Credit Card. With the EIB Carbon Credit Card, for every dollar you spend on yourself, an equal amount is spent on holistic carbon set-off projects, like planting trees along the border with Mexico to reforest the Southwest and create an impassable barrier.
We're lost, amigos. Let's go home.
You can be part of creating kelp farms in the ocean, teaching dolphins to feed penguins, harnessing the rays of the sun to power a windmill. And best of all, the EIB Carbon Credit Card isn't just for people like you. It's also great for governments, too. Go ahead, buy a half-decaf cafe latte and comfort a whale. Buy a sweater and send life-saving ice to a polar bear cub. Or send up the space shuttle and reforest New Mexico. You can save the Earth with the new EIB Carbon Credit Card.
Do you suffer from affluenza?
Okay, folks, I'm watching Fox here during the break. You know what I just heard? Doug Schoen, who is a Democrat pollster, who in recent years has shown a proclivity to side with Republicans, be that as it may. You know what I just heard Doug Schoen say? The Republican Party has not shown an inclination to be inclusive in order to join with people to solve the nation's problems. The Republican Party has not shown the inclination to be inclusive. Now, what in the Sam Hill does that mean? We are to infer that Obama and the Democrats are inclusive. What does that mean? The Democrats are inclusive. Let's see, Obama has not talked to Boehner or the Republicans since July. Obama is not inclusive. He is exclusive when it comes to accepting Republican ideas to solve problems. He is dismissive. He impugns the Republicans have an idea. He says, too bad, I won. That's his right. He can do that. My point is, Obama's not inclusive, but it's thought that he is. The Republicans have more Hispanic elected officials than the Democrats do. The Republicans, you saw our convention. Republicans want success for everybody. Conservatives want everybody to be the best they can be. And Doug Schoen hasn't seen any evidence of our inclusiveness. I'm sorry, folks. That is just blatantly false, untrue, but it's out there. The Republicans have, I don't know how much outreach they've done to try to show that they're inclusive. Romney's whole campaign, his whole campaign was built around the fact that he was for everybody. He wanted to help every family. But Doug Schoen hasn't seen any evidence of Republicans' inclination to be inclusive. What does that mean? We're not for gay marriage? Does that mean that we don't want to pass out birth control pills? Does that mean that we're not for taxpayer-funded abortions? Does that mean we're not for amnesty for illegal aliens? Inclusive? Robin, Evansville, Indiana. Hi, great to have you on the EIB Network. Hello.
Hi, Mega Dittos Rush. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks very much.
As a woman, and a Republican woman, as a matter of fact, I just am totally disgusted with women not coming out to vote for Mitt Romney. How could you not want to move our country in the right direction instead of going backwards?
Well, you see, that we're getting to the rub of it here. apparently for the women who voted for Obama, he is taking the country in the right direction as far as they're concerned. And the right direction for them is making sure that Republicans don't take away their birth control pills or their right to have an abortion. And I'm not exaggerating. It's what the exit polls show.
Well, it's crazy to believe that. It's crazy to believe that they could do that or would do that.
For you and me, it's crazy to believe that anything Obama does works. We're living in the midst of it not working. We're living in the absolute destruction and failure of this economy in this country.
Exactly. As a woman, how can you not notice when you go to the grocery store that the prices of food's gone up?
Price of food doesn't matter. It's that the next time to go to the grocery store, the birth control pills might not be there if Romney is elected.
Oh, too bad. Figure out a way to pay for your own birth control. There are free clinics still in this country.
It's not their job to provide their own birth control. That's the purpose of government. And that's what Obama is going to ensure, that whenever they have it and want it, they're going to get it.
That's not how it works. God helps those who help themselves.
Well, I know it's not how it works, but that's who those... We are outnumbered now by people who think that way, Robin. This is what we've got. We can sit here and lament all day why they think what they think. The fact is they do.
Well, I used to think that way at one time.
Well, what changed you?
I married a very conservative man.
You're letting a man run your life. You've already let women down. See, that's why you don't count.
No, not necessary.
I'm telling you the way Gloria Steinem thinks. You're an embarrassment to sisterhood.
Oh, dear.
What do you mean? Your husband determines what you think? How could you say that?
I mean,
you think it's funny. I'm telling you, this is who they are.
Oh, I know it's who they are, and I'm ashamed it's how they are.
I'm scared of how they are.
I am too. It's scary
because I don't know how to reach these people.
I don't know. If I had that answer, Rush, I'd be a millionaire.
I shudder to think what they think of me. I mean, I'm right behind Romney and taking stuff away from them as far as they're concerned.
Oh, well, you're the Antichrist sometimes, Rush. That's what they think of you.
Exactly.
I thought you were crazy at first, too, until I started really listening to you. And I'm like, well, he's right. He's right at what he says. He's
I don't imagine
the
a guy
on
the,
what he says.
Guy on the radio can ruin their life. And only the President of the United States can save them, as far as they're concerned. But anyway, that's who voted for the guy, folks. It's here in the exit poll data. I shared it with you at the top of the program. I mean, he got a majority of votes from people who think he, far and away, much better in an international crisis. Libya, Benghazi, Arab Spring. I know the media didn't tell the story. That's another thing, too. But that's what it is as well. You sit here and cry over that all we want, but that's what we're dealing with. And we're outnumbered by these people now. That's hard, cold reality.
With Rush, principles still matter on the EIB Network.
Eight years after going to work for then-Governor George W. Bush, 6 years after he started working at the White House, and 2 years after being out of work with no prospect of employment, Scott McClellan now says he felt compelled to speak out for the first time in his new book, Whatever Happened to Scott McClellan.
I just remembered that things were really bad at the White House, and I think speaking out can make a difference.
This red-hot blockbuster is full of secret personal insights from Scott, like...
We need to move beyond the bitter partisanship of Washington politics and just roll over.
Find out what was really going on with Karl Rove and Scooter Libby.
I was kept out of the loop by Karl and Scooter, who went behind closed doors to laugh at me behind my back.
Discover who was really behind the CIA leak.
Richard Armitage? No, I've never heard of him.
Critics are raving about whatever happened to Scott McClellan. I couldn't have written it better myself, says Anita Hill. So believable. I sent one to my pastor, says Barack Obama. And George Soros says,
forget MoveOn.org. This is the best money I've ever invested.
Whatever happened to Scott McClellan? From Lefty Press and bookstores today, in flea markets tomorrow. New from Crapital Records.
Fritz Hollings.
There's corruption everywhere out there.
And James Carville.
That's right. Corruption at the highest level.
Too much corrupting going on out there.
Dueling bozos.
We all know what's causing it.
Hollings and Carville together for the first time.
Too much corrupting going on out there. And it's even corrupted me.
Singing the only tune they know.
Yeah, everybody's guilty. I mean, come on.
Nothing we can do about it, no matter where we go. We go to breakfast, we go to Wednesday afternoon square dances.
We need to change the law.
I never even knew the word exacerbate until I came to Washington. I went down to that barbecue.
Wasn't that in the Star Report?
Why was LBJ here? Who the hell cares anymore anyway? All I know is that it was corrupt then and it's exacerbating now.
Yeah, all they're out there doing is talking about Buddhist monks.
They found this woman guilty. Guilty of what?
So what are you doing about it?
So what am I doing? I'm trying to pass a constitutional amendment to make sure that nobody can give any money to politicians.
Especially politicians that fly the Confederate flag.
I flew that flag. I flew it proudly.
That the
far as I'm concerned, George Bush is the one who's got to explain it. Ha ha! That's how out of whack it is. It's so corrupt, so exacerbating that a brief truck had to bring in a pork-flowing barbecue with a bunch of contributors that nobody has ever met. Until we get going, nothing's going to get
Dueling Bozos. Available wherever this record is sold. What better gift for the liberal on your list?
Folks, there is another explanation for this. Voting machines, all of them are rigged. The exit polling is BS. George Soros planned all of that to support the results. And he just let a couple Republicans win House races to make it look like he didn't rig everything. That's a possibility, too. We'll be back, though.
Attention, EIP affiliates. Stand by for the Rush Limbaugh promo feed. Copyright 2012. EIP Network. Start all recording devices in 3, 2, 1, now.
Rush Limbaugh.
Romney's recipe was the old standby American route to success. Hard work. That gets sneered at. I'm sorry.
Rush Limbaugh.
In a country of children where the option is Santa Claus or work, what wins? It is practically impossible to beat Santa Claus. People are not going to vote against Santa Claus, especially if the alternative is being your own Santa Claus. Romney's recipe was the old standby American route to success. Hard work. That gets sneered at. I'm sorry. In a country of children where the option is Santa Claus or work, what wins? It is practically impossible to beat Santa Claus. People are not going to vote against Santa Claus, especially if the alternative is being your own Santa Claus. I don't want anybody misunderstanding me here, because I think Mitt Romney is one of the best human beings I've ever met.
The Rush Limbaugh Weekend Review.
This was not a conservative campaign. We're going to have to go back and redefine how prosperity happens in this country. And conservatism and the Constitution are the best way to do this.
He's the first name in talk radio.
Rush Limbaugh giving you tomorrow's news today while we provoke the media and the rest of the left with incontrovertible truth.
The mission is clear.
To protect and defend the principles that form the foundation of our country.
Keep it right here for the next Rush Limbaugh radio program.
Don't miss it. Fireworks guaranteed. See you then.
This concludes the promo feed.
Production directors everywhere,
be with us next time
as we make your life easier
on the EIB Network.
Now, an official announcement by our dear leader, Barack Hussein Obama.
Every day, people all across America are spreading vicious stories and taking my name in vain. To get reelected, we must fight against the truth that blocks our way. That's why I created AttackWatch.com, a website devoted to shutting down the free expression of all subversive counter-revolutionary ideas. A place where you can report those who spread rumors, nasty emails, and public utterances attacking me. If you love me, you'll turn in anyone engaged in these types of activity. Friends, family, associates, children, anyone.
If you're tired of hearing how President Obama single-handedly screwed up the economy, hijacked healthcare, mishandled foreign policy...
That's enough!
Drop the ball!
I'm turning you in!
Wanted old people to take a pill and die!
AttackWatch.com. We're watching you.
Now, President Obama explains the consequences of Obamacare to calm the masses.
By now, most of you know that the Supreme Court recently decided that John Roberts wants a social life in D.C. But he also said we can impose a penalty on people getting a free ride by not purchasing my health insurance.
It's a tax.
What, John?
I said it's a tax.
Do you really want a Christmas card this year, Mr. Chief Justice?
Okay, never mind.
And that's not all we did. To punish the freeloaders who actually do buy insurance, we charge a premium tax to the insurer that they...
You mean penalty.
Oops. Thanks, John. Yes, we're going to penalize the irresponsible, lazy good-for-nothings who create and distribute prescription drugs, medical devices, businesses who hire more than 50 people, special needs children, and tanning salons, just to name a few. See? Now that mandate thing doesn't sound so scary, does it?
Paid for by friends of Obama. Who know he's failing.
Give me just a little more time, little and more the economy time. Will surely grow.
Give him just a little more time.
Give me just a little more time, and
time.
Healthcare will surely flow.
Give him just a little more time.
Life's too short to make a mistake. Let's pass healthcare and don't hesitate. I don't care how skeptical you may be. This is about you, it's not about me. If we don't do it now, you'll surely regret it. Healthcare's a right, in the Constitution we shred it. Give me just a little more time, and the economy will surely grow. Give me just a little more time, and healthcare will surely flow. You're getting scared, 'cause I'm in a hurry. I'm eager for control, but don't you worry. We both want the same things in life. Well, you'll have your kind of health care and I'll have mine. Don't give up on me, 'cause business is slow. We're gonna succeed with the stimulus, I hope. Give me just a little more time, and the economy will surely grow. Give me just a little more time. Unemployment will surely slow. Baby, trust Barry. With a little more time, we can do anything we want to. With a little more time.
Hey, folks, I know you're in shock. I know you don't believe this. I know you don't understand it, despite my heroic efforts to explain this. And I'm with you. Look, I lived through the last 2 months with you. I know exactly what was going on. Let us review, shall we? Let's take a look at some things. First, we had the Redskin rule. Didn't count this year. We had the rising unemployment number throughout the Obama regime, even though it got under 8% right before the election. The unemployment situation in this country is a disaster. There aren't any jobs being created. There certainly aren't any good ones, and there's no end in sight to what currently is going on. Mitt Romney was at 52% a week ago in the Gallup poll. Mitt Romney was up by 5 or 6 points for 3 or 4 or 5 days in a row. Obama never got to 50 until the day before the election. Never got to 50. The crowd turnouts, standing room only, had to change venues for Romney. Obama can't fill tiny venues. He had to move his convention speech from outdoors to indoors because they couldn't round up people to fill the stadium. They had to move indoors in Las Vegas. Couldn't find people to fill the outdoor stadium. 20,000 there. The last day on the trail is in Ohio. He's got Bruce Springsteen. He's got Jay-Z. Half-filled arena. There's all the anecdotal evidence. All the energy that was with Romney. All of the dead signs of resignation and defeat that accompanied Obama. And we had the black pastors that, where the hell we're voting for this guy? This guy, we don't believe in gay marriage. We don't like the fact Obama's linking homosexuality to the civil rights movement. We're not voting for him. And we're having all of our parishioners not vote for him. And we had the religious efforts on the Romney side. Of course, I don't know that materialized. I haven't been able to find out what the evangelical vote turned out to be. But there was nothing that pointed to an Obama win, other than the polls, which showed it tied. Other than Obama constantly at 48%, other than those polls and the media, there were no external fundamental signs that Obama was going to win. Then you dig deep in the exit polls, and according to the exit polls, only 4 in 10 voters thought the economy is getting better, and they voted for Obama. What? Scratch your head. According to the exit polls, in addition to that, just 25% of voters thought they're better off financially today than they were 4 years ago, and they still voted for Obama. And then Hurricane Sandy. Obama gets credit for showing up with Chris Christie, and that is said what won the election for him. It's what killed Romney's momentum. That's what everybody said. An hour and a half, 2 hours on the max in New Jersey, on the ground, accomplishing nothing, with no improvement anywhere in New Jersey or New York for anybody, and Obama is said to get credit for fixing it. No president has ever been reelected with an unemployment number over 7.2%. 64% of all voters said that Obama's response to the devastation from Superstorm Sandy was a factor in their vote. 64%, according to the exit polls. None of this makes sense. None of this jibes with the feelings. No, I take it back. Before the election, my thoughts, when I would think about this, and I told you this on election, there's no way Obama wins this, but my feeling, I felt concerned. You can ask anybody, you can ask my brother. I had people telling me, asking me, Monday and Tuesday, please tell me we're going to win this big, please. And I didn't. I never privately told anybody I thought we're going to win this big. But I'm like you. Last night, watching all this stuff come in, it doesn't jibe with anything we saw. And yet it happened. So there has to be a reason for it. I don't subscribe to massive multiple state voting machine fraud or any of that. That's just too big an undertaking. And if that is what happened, I don't know how we're ever going to. Don't even want to go there. I do believe, however, I can intellectually believe that we're outnumbered by the people that voted for Obama. He turned them out. I mean, there is no denying he turned them out. There's no denying the way they voted. A lot of it doesn't make sense until you accept that we have allowed the understanding of what creates prosperity in this country to be blown up into smithereens. We have permitted the education system in this country to be blown up to smithereens, kindergarten all the way through graduate school. It is a disaster. Now, what's going to happen? Well, let me go through the list of possibilities here of what can happen in the country. And in no particular order, by the way. One thing that could happen is that the economy could continue to get worse as more Obamacare is implemented and Obama gets his tax increases. The Bush tax cuts will end, and that will lead to tax increases anyway. That will result in more money being taken out of the private sector. The government will get bigger. Obama will continue to borrow. He will continue to spend. He'll continue to provide for people. The people on the receiving end of Obama's Santa Claus behavior will not necessarily feel the negative impact of the economy as those of you who are working or recently lost their jobs or those of you paying the freight will feel. And it will continue and continue until it collapses. It could happen in 18 months. It could happen in 3 years. But if nothing changes the track we're on, we are facing a financial collapse. And as we've seen in Greece and Spain, the people that live there don't care that their countries are collapsing. They just want their pensions, and they want their checks, and they want their union contracts to continue to be paid. They don't care what's happening to their government. They don't care what's happening to the country. They don't care who's paying for it. By God, it better not stop. Same thing will happen here. There's another possibility. The American people are extremely resilient. The question is, are there enough Americans who will roll up their sleeves? You know what? I'm just not putting up with this. I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to start a business. I'm going to work hard. I'm going to try to find a job. And will the economy on its own, because of the resilience of the American people, show some signs of life and begin to recover? If that happens, can I tell you what else is going to happen? Obama's policies are going to get the credit for it. All the spending, all the borrowing, all the stimulus, all the green energy, all that stuff will be proclaimed as the reason why. And we will continue to lose the understanding of how genuine prosperity is created in this country. It will be forever distorted. Investors Business Daily has a piece today, 5 big stories the media will discover after the election. And there is a commonality to second terms, presidential second terms, and that is they never fulfill expectations. Something happens. It happened to Reagan, Iran-Contra. It happened to Clinton, Monica Lewinsky. It happened to George W. Bush. Finally, the Iraq War took its toll, and you know the story of the last 4 Bush years. Bush started his second term saying he was going to spend his capital to reform and privatize Social Security, and you saw what happened with that. They demagogued that. Bush pulled it off the table, and a whole new argument began over the government is the best protector of people. You can't rely on the private sector, Wall Street, and you can't have people respond to themselves or depend on themselves. The government has to do it. Nixon had Watergate in his second term. It is also said that the media could possibly get tired of protecting and defending Obama and now go after him. Just because that's who they are. That they're vampires and they have to feed. And there's only so many Republicans to feed off of now. Most of them are gone. Well, I know they got me, but it's a long shot. I'm just telling you, these are things that are possible. Benghazi is going to rear its head. Benghazi, you know, these blissfully ignorant voters who are totally unaware of it last night are going to finally hear about this. But then the question, will they care? Probably not, folks. Not the Obama voters. They probably won't care if they don't care about anything else. But the five stories Investor's Business Daily says the media will discover, quote unquote, the economy really does stink. The press studiously ignored the ongoing economic catastrophe under Obama while parading any green shoot they could find that suggested growth was just around the corner. Don't be surprised if after the election they start to notice that the 3 years of subpar growth have left the middle class further behind and more mired in poverty. That's wishful thinking. The press is invested in this guy. The press is so tied to this guy because of race. There's no way. I stand to be corrected on this, but I mean, the press made this guy who he is, but you know, normally press likes to take people down that they've built up. Do you see them taking Obama down? Do you see Chuck Todd ripping into Obama? You see Chris Matthews ripping into Obama? You see Scott Pelley ripping into, you see Brian Williams ripping into Obama? No, they're going to be ripping into me. Make no mistake about that. By the way, it won't take the end of this week, folks. I'm going to be, not Chris Christie, I'm going to be the reason all this happened. Just warning you. I will be the reason. And it'll be said, if a Republican Party wants to have a future, they're going to have to shut up people like me. And stop listening to people like me, LA extremists. In fact, it has already started in certain sectors of the Republican consultants' ranks. It's already started. Number two on the Investor's Business Daily list of stories they'll discover, massive debt and entitlement crises loom. Despite four straight years of trillion-plus dollar deficits and a national debt that now exceeds the GDP, you know, you think anybody voted for Obama even knows what that means? If you could have gone to the McCormick place last night, before Obama came out, accepted his speech, his victory speech, you just pick anybody out of that crowd and say, do you people understand here that the national debt exceeds the GDP? How many of them at McCormick Place would have the slightest idea what you're talking about? I'll say conservatively less than 5%. What's national debt? And really, what do you mean GDP? And then, after you told them, they'd say, okay, what's the problem? This is part and part. We just assume, you know, these things we throw out that we understand that the national debt exceeds the GDP. We just assume people are going to understand what that means. I have to tell you that your average Obama voter not only doesn't know, but can't be made to care. It's not about any of that. The only way the average Obama voter is going to care about that is if it's going to personally interrupt the flow of goodies, income, or whatever that he's getting from government. Number three, the debt ceiling limit is fast approaching. Another story went largely unremarked on in the campaign is the fact As the country's approaching the new debt ceiling limit, Treasury Department warned last week expects the government to reach its borrowing limit before the end of the year. I take you back to McCormick Place. Pick any Obama voter out of that massive crowd last night. So you know what? The debt ceiling is coming up. You're going to have to... We're going to have to make special arrangements to keep borrowing. Okay, well, so do it, they'll say. What's the problem? I mean, if we've reached the limit, just raise it. Problem solved. And then, if you say, well, do you know what the debt limit is? Well, I assume it's, you know, what would debt that we should limit? That's exactly right. Next story that IBD says that the media will discover Obamacare isn't what it's cracked up to be. After 2 years of ignoring health reform's fundamental flaws, the press will likely admit that Obamacare is fundamentally flawed. Head back to McCormick Place. Do you realize that Obamacare is going to cost the average American an additional $2,500 in premiums? I don't care. I'm not paying for it. Oh, yes, you will. You wait. I'm not going to pay for it. I'm not paying for my health care now. The union takes care of that, or the government. Yeah, but are you aware that the IRS has 16,000 new agents that are going to be running around making sure that if you don't have health insurance, you're paying a fine? I don't believe that. I don't believe that. Well, that's true. Your average McCormick Place attendee, no. A fine for not having health? No. Besides, Obama's going to provide it. And the other issue, Obama's deficit-cutting plan won't work. Do you think they really care about deficit? I don't
get the most outrageous Obama parodies ever on Paul Shanklin's new hilarious CD, You Didn't Build That. Available only at paulshanklin.com. That's Paul, S-H-A-N-K-L-I-N.com.
Hey, he didn't build that!
You're listening to the EIB Network. Now, continuing coverage on the countdown to disaster. As the clock runs out on the nation's debt ceiling limit, President Obama speaks again.
My fellow Americans, in just a few days, the United States government will run out of money, which is driving the Asian markets crazy.
You cut spending, grow economy, pay back debt.
See what I mean? Crazy. Checks to our seniors, our soldiers, and the unemployed are all in jeopardy because I will spend what little money we have left on green jobs and other important initiatives that we have...
Shut up! Make plan, pay debt!
A plan?
You are ineffective.
I did get those apples in the Happy Meals.
Stay tuned for continuing coverage on the Countdown to Disaster. Be an army of at least one. By volunteering for duty as a DNC seminar caller, you'll receive advanced basic training from our sensitive, caring professionals.
What's your number, soldier?
1-800-282-2885.
How you gonna make it past the call screen if you don't know the number? Drop and give me 20 on the rotary dial. The rest of you, repeat after me. I love your show, and I always agree with you. And I voted for Bush.
And you'll earn promotions and medals.
Son, we're very proud of you. What's that medal for?
This one's for touch tone. This is for getting past the call screener. And this big one here is for actually talking to the host and flawlessly saying, I love your show, I always agree with you, and I voted for Bush.
Be on radio and say what we want you to say. All scripts provided by the Democratic National Committee. Help us take back our monopoly on public opinion. Volunteers especially needed from noon to 3 Eastern. Now, an urgent global warming message from Albert Gore Jr.
The more we study global warming, the more we learn. Take cow flatulence, for instance. Recent studies have shown that the abundance of gas from cow flatulence is more dangerous than automobile emissions. So right here on my Tennessee farm, we're studying new holistic farming methods to reduce cow flatulence. We've already stopped the emission of gas from Gertrude here by using nothing but natural cork. Then, we've gently massaged her to reduce stress and anxiety, the root causes of cow flatulence. Now, we'll apply acupuncture to... Oh, Darn. Lost another one. Well, science is a continual learning process. Can somebody get me a handy wipe? Make that two.
Folks, there are quite a few facts, a lot of facts actually, that'll emerge after the election yesterday, including just how engaged all of us were. We knew the stakes were high. Obama's re-election, it'll be enough for him to claim a mandate. And you know what his mandate's going to be? What's Obama's mandate? No, it's Bush's fault. That's the mandate. What else could the mandate be? They can make the mandate. In fact, I've got stories. Here, Ron Fournier, Obama victory comes with no mandate. In fact, I've got stories here. Let me just say this. NPR, ABC News, U.S. News and World Report, Christian Science Monitor, and a bunch of small local papers all have stories and now Obama has no mandate. He didn't run on any issues. This is some people think it's the first sign of the press. Now, you know, okay, second term, okay, Barack, honeymoon's over, finally. But Ron Fournier, I mean, it was in the tank for Obama. No mandate. He doesn't have a mandate. Now, as far as Obama's supporters concerned, his mandate's whatever he wants to do. And the best I can come up, his mandate is to blame Bush and the Republicans for 4 more years. Because that's what he did the first 4. Now, he's going to claim that he's got a mandate to expand the government even more beyond anything that we've ever known. And we've suffered a setback, folks, but we have not given up on our principles. And that's important. Nobody is giving up, but we are facing reality here. We've got two things that happened here. We are either outnumbered and are losing ground, or one of the most outrageous thefts of an election in the history of elections taking place. One of those two things happened. You take your pick, but reality is reality. We are in for some rough times. And my buddies at the Heritage Foundation would remind you of a thought. There are no permanent victories. There are no permanent defeats in Washington. What there is a permanent struggle. They have been in it for 40 years. They've won some, they've lost some, but they have won more than they've lost, and they're in the game every day. Check out their new website, the Heritage Foundation. It's signwithheritage.org, S-I-G-N, signwithheritage.org. That's the new website they've set up. As everybody gears up for whatever is coming next, and we are coming next after a brief timeout here at the bottom.
Now, behind the scenes on the campaign trail with Barack Obama.
Come in.
Mr. President, thanks for coming on the show. I just thought we should go over what you want to say tonight.
Well, I am a bit nervous.
Just be yourself. Say some of the stuff you got to say.
Okay. Well, after 2.5 years, I just realized people are hurting. We need to create more jobs.
Create jobs, so?
So, I want to tax anyone with enough money to employ people.
That's good. Great punchline. Work on the delivery. Go on.
In Libya, I was able to take credit for the end of Gaddafi because we spent $1 billion and had no troops on the ground.
Go on, keep going.
I want to make it easier for people to get new loans for houses that aren't worth what they paid for them. Joe Biden is a great vice president. Michelle believes in moderation.
Stop it.
We have stabilized the economy. Recovery is just around the corner.
You're a natural. Come on, let's go out there. I'll pitch you some softballs.
Okay.
Join us next time we take you behind the scenes on the campaign trail with Barack Obama.
A lot of us are not going to let that happen.
Ever wonder how Barbara Boxer keeps that uptight, uncomfortable look all day long? She's got her thong on. And now you can keep it uptight, too. Celebrate spring with the environmental thong made with dried leaves, moss, and twigs. Or keep leaks to yourself with a dependable Pat Leahy mop. It only leaks when you want it to. All our boxers are unisex and come in only one size, extra, extra small, for that uniquely uptight look that's so fashionable with your left-wing buddies. Now you, too, can look uptight and uncomfortable all day long. And if you ever feel a smile coming on, just cinch it up a little higher. Just ask Ron Reagan Jr. So just throw out the old boxers and get your thong on with the Barbara Boxer Thong Collection. Check out the Barbara Boxer Thong Collection wherever left-wing loonies are found. And now back to America's most scintillating talk show, the Tom Daschle Show.
Tom Daschle!
Welcome back to America's most scintillating talk show, the Tom Daschle Show. I'm Tom Daschle, and I tell you, I am excited about our new network of over six whole stations. So watch out, Limbaugh. We're coming after you here on the Tom Daschle Show.
Tom,
I've got a very
Daschle!
Special guest on our newsmaker line, John F. Kerry. Let's give him a hand. Welcome, John, to the Tom Daschle Show.
Thank you, Tom.
Now, John and I go way back. He has stood his ground for liberals everywhere. He's voted against tax cuts, defense budgets, school choice, you name it.
Let's don't talk about that right now.
Don't be shy, John.
Well, I also voted for those things before I voted against them.
You and I know how you really feel.
No, Tom. I'm running for president.
Huh?
I'm running for president.
Maybe we should talk about some targeted tax cuts, after we break for these important commercial messages.
Tom Daschle!
Now the lights have gone out here on the Tom Daschle Show.
My mic's off. Could you turn my mic back on? Is there a problem?
What do you mean we're out of money?
Okay, we're going back to phones. We're going to Los Angeles, and this is Yakov is with us now. Hi, Yakov. Great to have you on the program. Hello.
Hey, great to talk to you, Rush Limbaugh.
Thank you, sir.
This is an honor. You know, in the early 90s, I was going to college. I was president of the Young Democrats at the time, believe it or not. And a gentleman said to me something very brilliant that you said yesterday, so I know where he got it from. And that I called myself a moderate. And he said to me, he says, a moderate is nothing but a liberal who has no guts. So,
yeah, liberal without the guts to say is a liberal, yep.
Exactly. So that was quite amazing to hear that you brought me back yesterday. And, of course, I've changed my stance, and I have the guts to say I'm a conservative today. So, and you've helped out a lot with that. Reason I'm calling in today is because, you know, I am highly disappointed in how out of touch the Republicans have become with who they're speaking with, not with what they stand for. I loved Romney. There's nobody more qualified for president in my lifetime than Romney. I really believe that. But our message to the people should not have been to the people who already know that. The reason that Obama won is he did not go to the people who have some intelligence and are liberal and they already knew who they were voting for. He didn't go to the women that already knew who they were voting for, or the Hispanics who already knew, or the blacks who already... He went to the homeless shelters. He went to the people who were on welfare, that he was paying their salaries. He went to the people who are, you know, on unemployment, but they got their benefits extended. He went to the people who really don't understand how the economy works. You know, the people that have no...
He didn't have to go to them. His party has created them via the education system. He'd have to visit a homeless shelter. The people there already think what they think because Obama's party has gamed it.
Yeah. And those people have no clue what Republicans can do for them.
Yes, they do. Republicans mean they got to work. That's what they think Republicans mean, that they have to work.
Well, Rush, there's that element, but we've got a lot of people who are hardworking people who are unemployed today. And those people, they would love to be working. You know, but they're on the unemployment line, and they're also in the welfare lines. I mean, what did they say? 800 and something billion dollars more than the defense budget.
Right. Now. Well, what percentage of this group are you talking about? You think voted for Obama?
Well, it didn't need to be that many people. He just had to push them over the edge. The people who could be pushed, the people that could be swayed. Anybody who didn't vote last year.
If you're talking about hardworking people, and I agree with you, they're out there, hardworking, who really want to work and they really want jobs.
Yeah.
If they're engaged enough to want that, I would submit to you they have to know that their biggest obstacle is Obama and would vote against him.
If they know how government works. If they know how economy works. If they know that, you know, if you raise the taxes on a corporation, they're going to lay off people. You know, if they know that if you're going to tax people 35%, that they're going to add jobs. I mean, they haven't been taught to do that math. They haven't even been taught the basics. All they've been taught was back what you used to talk about back in the 90s. I remember you talking about baby seals. That's what the Democrats talk about. You know, they have their baby seal.
Well, baby seals, now they're talking about Hurricane Sandy, global warming, and green energy. But it's one thing or another. Well, you're basically saying what I'm saying, that Obama corralled the uninformed vote. But I'm submitting to you that some of the people that you say are uninformed are really not. They are informed enough to know that Obama is the guy that's going to make a lifestyle without work possible. 2 years of unemployment can reduce your work ethic. We know psychological studies, the longer you are out of work, the harder it is to go back. The longer you're out of work, the harder it is to look for a job, because you lose your self-esteem. You lose confidence. You don't think anybody would want you, and you don't think you can do the job. It really is a destructive thing, psychologically. And that is capitalized upon, played upon, by Democrats, liberals, statists, who want people like that precisely turning to the government for their solution. And put a cherry on top of that, little icing on that cake. You tell those people that they're in that circumstance because Republicans own all these corporations and won't hire anybody because they want to keep the profits for themselves. It's a never-ending cycle. Yakov, I'm glad you called. It's great to have you out there. I appreciate it. This is Julie, Morgantown, West Virginia. Hi, welcome to the EIB Network. Hello.
Hi. Thanks for taking my call.
You bet.
You're the first person I wanted to talk to after yesterday because how logical you are. I think it's a twofold problem that kind of go hand in hand, and am in agreement with you. I think it's an info-reaching problem and an image-reaching problem. Obviously, the info is pretty obvious as far as how the liberal news media covers things, but I have a brother who's a moderate. I would consider a moderate. And
by the way, I would say it's more how the media doesn't cover things with Obama than what they do cover, or even how they cover it. It's what they don't cover that is the big problem.
Yeah, I think people don't know what they're getting. My brother, I brought up Benghazi to him, and he had heard briefly about the situation, but he had no clue the details. And
well, what was his reaction when you gave him the details?
He was really shocked about it, and I also had meant he's in pharmaceuticals, and I told him his company is kind of waiting, they've had cutbacks and they're kind of waiting to see, like January, he wasn't sure what's going to happen with his company, and I said, well, you know what they're waiting for, and he said, no, what, and I said. They're waiting to see if Obama gets in or not. I said, because if Obama gets in, you could really see some cuts or even exposure of your company.
He
had no clue.
I'm sure he didn't. Most people don't. It's going to be fun to be here on the day in January people get their first paychecks.
Oh, yeah.
When they see the Bush tax cuts ending, and that's going to affect everybody, not just the rich, and the payroll tax and some of the Obamacare taxes, because it's a whole bunch of stuff that kicks in January that I'd be really interested to see. I really will be interested to see how people react to that.
But I think the Democrats Obama has done a good job at not just getting on the news media, but putting himself. I think there's an image problem that Republicans have and conservatives have in that, and it's not. I don't even think it directly, has anything to do with how Romney comes off. I think that. I know people that are liberals that think all conservatives are against alternative energy and against helping people, which is exactly the opposite. But they're not informed. They're kept in, if you don't listen to you or, other strictly conservative outlets, you don't get the image, the true image of what a conservative is. On some of these issues.
Well, clearly there's a branding problem the Republican Party has. So you could say it's marketing, branding, image. Clearly it exists. And the main reason it does is that I don't know anybody. I really don't. Even I'm 25 years into this program. And if I were to be asked, how do you fight people lying about you? I don't know what. I to this day, I don't know how to deal with that. Other than being who you are every day. But look at what they did to Romney in the early parts of the campaign. And by proud admission, they did this. They lied. Romney was responsible for a guy's wife dying from cancer. The press knew it wasn't true, but they marveled at the audacity and brilliance of the Obama campaign. Stephanie Cutter was lying through her teeth every day about Romney being a felon, about herself not being involved in the commercial involving a guy's wife who died with cancer. Then they say that Romney's a felon, then they say Romney's got this, Romney did. They caricatured Mitt Romney as the most mean-spirited, vicious, lying criminal, near felon, didn't care about somebody's wife thing. 180 degrees from the truth. The media knew it was happening. Romney didn't respond to it because he's busy raising money at that moment in order to run ads later on in the campaign. That's why Obama timed the Romney dirt campaign when they did. So Romney, throughout the campaign, never once, the convention was the only effort that was made to refute any of that, but they didn't say, by the way, what you're hearing about me isn't true. They just brought person after person after person up to testify what essentially a great, charitable, nice guy Romney is, and hope that it spoke for itself. But there is no antidote. And see, we are kind of hamstrung because we don't think we have to lie about the Democrats. All we have to do is tell the truth about where their policies will lead, about what they intend with their policies. That truth doesn't carry the day as often as their lies carry the day. It's a psychological thing. I'm not equipped to tell anybody how to deal with being lied about. I'm somebody who is lied about routinely. Anyway, I appreciate the call. I'm way long here. I wish I had more time to delve into this with you, but I've got to take a break. We'll be back after this.
The most powerful name in talk radio, Rush, on the EIB Network. According to a leading authority, when presented with a problem, 95% of Americans sit on their hands while only 5% do something about it.
I thought we'd get a couple of things on the way to the party.
Yeah, grab a shopping cart.
Oh, it's stuck. I guess we'll just have to carry everything.
Well, let me try. There, see?
Don't be part of the problem. Be part of the solution.
Boy, I'm thirsty. You want a soda?
Yeah, sure.
Oh, it didn't take my dollar. Well, that's okay. I can wait.
Well, try it again, like this. There you go.
If you have a friend that gives up too soon, you know what to do.
You know, I haven't seen Bob, and I... It didn't start. Maybe we should call Mother.
Hey, you give up too easy. Give her another try. Why don't we listen to Rush on the way?
Who's Rush?
A guy you really gotta get to know.
Listen to Rush on the EIB Network.
I rode with my kid in the front seat to soccer practice. Does that make me a bad parent?
Yes, it does. And you would have known if you read Bad Living magazine.
There's a new study that shows people who eat red meat from cows that inhaled secondhand smoke are 3% more likely to get sick than people who don't. Should I be scared?
Yes, and that's the point of Bad Living. When you subscribe to Bad Living, you'll be reminded of all the ways you put yourself and those around you in danger every day.
I didn't even realize that my SUV was endangering other drivers and destroying the ozone hole and increasing our chances of getting hit by a giant asteroid. But since I subscribed to Bad Living, I'm afraid of almost everything, and I want everyone around me to be too.
Call now and receive the bonus pamphlet, The Top 1500 Things You Should Be Terrified About.
I called, and I'm glad I did. The first issue told me how to get rid of all the sharp objects in my home.
Call 1-800-PARANOID and receive our latest issue of Bad Living magazine, featuring 10 reasons you should be afraid to leave your home.
Thanks, Bad Living.
New at Club Gitmo, life skills training. So you can thrive on the outside when you leave our tropical retreat from Jihad.
I love my life skills training classes. When I first came to Club Gitmo, they just asked me a lot of personal questions. Now I ask the questions in class.
You'll learn all about personal finance, computer skills, how to read a wiring diagram, and improve your English to make you a lot less suspicious.
My favorite teacher is Mr. Shabazz. He has taught me to hate America even more than I thought possible.
The only good cracker is a dead cracker.
Fight the power.
Fight the power.
Fight the power.
Fight the power.
Life skills training. Now at Club Gitmo, your tropical retreat from Jihad.
What about a whole wheat cracker?
Hate all the crackers.
Fight the power. The power.
Ladies and gentlemen, a message to all our servicemen and women from your Commander-in-Chief, President Barack Obama.
For far too long, we've given medals and citations for strength and bravery in battle, ignoring those who didn't fire their weapon or attempt to achieve their objective. Let me be clear, from this day forward, that will change.
Introducing the Yellow Heart, an historic new presidential medal awarded posthumously for restraint in combat.
The Yellow Heart symbolizes my administration's attitude of fair play on the battlefield, no matter what the cost.
And there's so much more. Now, if you desert your unit, you'll receive the AWOL Ribbon of Peace. And for treacherous behavior beyond the call of Allah, you'll learn the works and plays well with the enemy, knife in the back with gold leaf.
Take it from me, John F. Kerry.
I was in Vietnam, and I wouldn't throw these over a fence for the world.
The Presidential Medal Collection. Combat medals for everyone.
Okay, here's how it works. Chris Van Hollen, he's the number two or three guy in the House Democrats. He's from Maryland. And he just said, if the Republicans do not go along with Obama's tax increases on the rich, then we have a financial collapse awaiting. Was that his word, financial collapse? We're going over the financial cliff. If the Republicans don't agree to Obama's tax increases on the rich, we're going over the financial cliff. Now, you could confiscate every dollar of income of $1 million or over. You could take every, not tax, just take everything anybody has over $1 million, and you wouldn't make a dent in any, you couldn't run the government for more than a month. So Chris Van Hollen is telling us we are going over the financial cliff. We are going to go over the financial cliff, folks. Everybody in the Obama camp knows we are going over the financial cliff. Whether we raise taxes on the rich or not, we're going over the financial cliff. Raising taxes, confiscating the wealth's money would not save us. There isn't the money. But this is how this works now. This is how they do it. Pressure's on now the Republicans. It's not Obama, you see, whose policies are going to take us over financially. Oh, no! It's these Republican creeps that won't go along with tax increases. My friends, thousands of companies move in and open an office with our good buddies at Regis every month. More than half of the Fortune 500 actually take offices at one Regis location or another, and these are big, successful companies for now, who choose to use Regis versus rent more of their own space. Now, you know your own business, and I have mine, Two If By T. We discovered Regis. Why all the demand? Well, it's a brilliant business model. You don't buy anything. You know, the furniture's yours, the phone number's yours, receptionist is yours, all the IT equipment's yours, everything in there is yours when you use it. And when you walk out of there, it isn't yours. You pay for it as you use it. They got offices all over the world. You need an office for 3 hours next Friday? Regis has it. Except when you're there, it's yours. And you don't have to lay out a bunch of money for year-long office space and hiring a bunch of staff and stuff. All that's done for you. You call Regis at 1-800-OFFICES and check into what they've got. Or check them on the web, Regis.com, R-E-G-U-S, R-E-G-U-S.com. And if you sign up, use my name. It'll knock 2 months off of your initial charge or your bill. But it's the most economical, sensible way to have office space when you need it, particularly if you don't need it every day. This is just right. Regis.com, 1-800-OFFICES.
He makes it look easy, but it's not. Rush on the EIB Network. A silent epidemic is sweeping the Democratic Party. Bird brain flu. Its symptoms are unmistakable. There's memory loss.
You say you don't support the war in Iraq now, but you voted for it.
I don't remember that.
Double standard vision.
Scooter Libby lied to a grand jury.
You didn't complain when Bill Clinton did it.
Yeah, but that was different.
And delusions.
We won the governor's race in New Jersey and Virginia. America's really behind us. We're going to kick butt in 06.
Wow, I feel better now.
And hysteria.
Global warming is melting the polar ice caps. Baby seals are dying.
Bird brain flu affects liberals in the prime of their lives. But there is a cure. Education. Instead of reading a bumper sticker, try picking up a book. Turn off the liberal media and tune into the Rush Limbaugh program.
I was really stuck on stupid, but I feel better now.
Inoculate yourself against bird brain flu. Listen to the Rush Limbaugh radio program, a public service message from the EIB network. And now, a message from the President of the United States.
My fellow Americans, in tough economic times like these, you should not go to Las Vegas
and blow all your cash to have fun. Come to where the real action is. Washington, D.C. Why pull a lever on a slot machine when you can take a chance and roll the dice on 1/6 of the economy with national health care? Double down on stimulus spending and win big money for your friends back home. Or if you're a really high roller like me, scare the banks and raise taxes right in the middle of a recession. Come on, 7. Ah, crapped out again. But believe me, you can't lose when you're playing with other people's money. Give me another trick. Make that 2. And they have great accommodations and food. You can have Kobe beef every night if you want. And when you leave Washington, they comp you with a fat pension and health care that's out of this world.
Travel provided by Pelosi Airlines. Catch an all-you-can-drink flight anytime you like, 24-7.
So what are you waiting for? Come to where the real action is, Washington, D.C., and leave Las Vegas behind.
Oh, it's so easy to love Dancer and Prancer, Donner and Blitzen, Vixen, and especially Rudolph. You know, Rudolph, the red-nosed reindeer. But what about the other side of the reindeer family, the caribou? The caribou get no cute song, no cuddly cartoons, no Christmas specials. The caribou, they have to fend for themselves in the frozen tundra, uncared for by the liberals. If the truth be known, it's the conservatives who love the caribou. It's the conservatives who care for the caribou, who want to see the caribou go forth and multiply. Conservatives for Caribou is a non-profit organization dedicated to increasing the caribou population. We can double, we can triple the caribou in the frozen tundra, but we need your help, not your money, your support. It'll take a pipeline to double the caribou population. Conservatives for Caribou want that pipeline. Daschle Democrats don't. Call Tom Daschle. Tell him to drop the petty politics. Let the caribou go forth and multiply. Support ANWR for the caribou. And now a message from the National Institute.
Now get this, the New York Times just posted a graphic, how Obama won re-election. And you know what their subhead is? Most of the nation shifted to the right in Tuesday's vote, but not far enough to secure a win for Mitt Romney. I wish I had time to delve into that. Maybe tomorrow, my friends. And remember, hard to vote against Santa Claus. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.